Welcome back to Tiny Epics, and thanks for tuning in. To everyone out there watching, I've got a very special guest today. We're joined by an absolute giant in the field of prehistoric archaeology, Colin Renfrew. His many important published works have helped shape the way we understand humanity's prehistoric past. And he's brought awareness to important ethical issues, such as looting, that continue to pose a great challenge for archaeology today. He's currently a senior fellow of the McDonald Institute for Archaeological Research at the University of Cambridge. It's my great pleasure to introduce today's guest, Colin Renfrew.
Thank you very much for your very kind words, which I appreciate.
I wanted to begin by talking about your most recent excavations on the Greek island of Keros. The discoveries you and your team made there were the focus of a documentary released this year. Could you tell us a little bit about what you found there?
Well, Keros, and particularly the little islet of Thaskalio, which is just to the west of Keros, is a fascinating location. And Thaskalio, in the early Bronze Age, around 2500 BC, was clearly a cultural center, and perhaps a religious center, for the Cycladic Islands. The remarkable finds, or the most striking finds, which are found not on Thaskalio, but on Avos, which is immediately opposite on the Keros side. They're divided these days by sort of 100 meters of water, but they were probably united as one unit in the early Bronze Age. And the remarkable finds are just dozens, indeed hundreds, of broken marble sculptures. And that is what at first attracted me to the site when I was doing my doctoral research in the 1960s. And just amazing the amount of sculptural material, that is to say marble sculptures, usually folded arm sculptures of the very typical early Cycladic style, and other finds of the early Bronze Age period around 2500 BC.
There are theories out there that these folded arm figures represented an important goddess which the prehistoric people of the Cycladic Islands perhaps worshipped. But you have a different take on the matter and propose that the figures are perhaps not a representation of a goddess at all.
Well, that's exactly right. Obviously, there's a great literature going back more than a century about mother goddesses and a great earth mother and so on. And indeed, a friend of mine, Maria Gimbutas, whom I very much admired, she was one of the scholars who developed ideas along those lines in a way that I found sometimes overambitious, to put it politely. But I think it is important to try and work out what this particular form, the folded arm figure, meant, because it occurs again and again. And I do regard it not so much as a religious representation, but as what one might call the icon for the culture, the cultural group in the Cycladic Islands, centered in some senses upon Keros. And I regard the folded arm figure representing, as it were, the community, in that sense, the icon of the community, but not necessarily being associated with a complex of religious beliefs. We can try and reconstruct the religious beliefs they may have had, but I see it rather as an icon, and we don't have to get over-involved in deep religious beliefs at the same time.
Yeah, it seems we sometimes have the tendency to impose our belief systems today onto people who lived 4,500 years ago.
That's exactly right. And so we have to ask very carefully to what extent did they have religious beliefs? To what extent can we document that they had religious beliefs? And so we have to proceed with that in a very careful way. And that's one of the tasks of cognitive archaeology. If we're trying to investigate the beliefs, the conceptual nature of the world of those communities, then we have to try and do that in a systematic way, and certainly not take a great jump to believe in a great Earth Mother. That's a possibility, but it's one that we have to try and investigate with the materials at hand.
In the film I mentioned earlier, you hint at a kind of pilgrimage that seems to have taken place over the course of many generations. with prehistoric people from the various Cycladic islands coming to Keros to gather and perform, perhaps, various ritual activities. You've used the expression symbolic attractor to describe important prehistoric sites such as Keros, or Stonehenge to give another more famous example. Could you tell us a little bit more about places which you might refer to as a symbolic attractor?
It is the case that there are various sites across the world that seemed to become centers of congregation. Mm. By that, I simply mean, really, that at certain times, quite large numbers of people congregated there, they visited there. Stonehenge is a very good example. Chaco Canyon is a good example much later in the United States. And there are other locations around the world that seem to have had the function of being a gathering place periodically. And the periodicity varies, not always easy to estimate, but sometimes it would be annually or be once every several years, like the Olympic Games. The Olympic Games is a very good example.
Now to turn our attention to a different topic, I know that rumors of looting is one of the things that first brought you to investigate Keros in the 1960s. Can you speak about looting in general and what challenges it poses for you as an archaeologist?
Well, I think it is the case that looting is the great bugbear of archaeology worldwide. It happens on all continents. If you're talking about Peru, if you're talking about Mexico, for example, there's been looting on a huge scale. And many of the finest finds in the museums of the world have derived from looting. There have been antiquities sales in recent years in Sotheby's, notably in New York, where Cycladic antiquities have gone for millions of dollars, and you have no certainty initially that they're genuine. You have to examine them carefully, and it's clear that there was, in the 1950s, a lot of looting going on Keros, and a lot of material that appeared on the art markets around that time or in the previous decade had been looted from Keros. And it's clear that there was a great catastrophe, really, where much of the material that the archaeologists should have been able to investigate systematically on Keros was looted in the previous 20 or 30 years from Keros. Even if you think it's authentic, you don't really want to say so. You don't want to encourage ongoing looting by authenticating looted material.
In contrast to the looted objects that you feel are authentic, I imagine that the forgeries, if they're good enough, also cause quite some confusion among scholars such as yourself who study these objects. Do you ever get into arguments with other scholars regarding the authenticity of certain objects?
There's one famous seated figure, the so-called Harpist, in the Metropolitan Museum in New York, and I got into great trouble with the Dietrich von Bottmer, who was associated with that museum, when I said in an early paper that I wrote that I thought this was a fake. I still think it's a fake, and I've said so clearly, and it's possible to make even serious curators angry if you cast aspersions at their prized exhibits. But that's certainly one that I said in my first paper on the subject many years ago now, and I've stood by that. I think it's a fake, so we've had words about that on several occasions.
Because of all these looted objects and forgeries out there, which we've discussed, there are lots of people out there who are rightfully skeptical of the authenticity of many of these objects. But this book, Early Cycladic Sculpture and Context, only features objects which have been properly excavated. Is that correct?
That was the point of it. When Dr. Mathari and I discussed doing that, and then my colleague Michael Boyd joined us, we thought we're only going to publish in that book Cycladic antiquities of whose authenticity we can be completely confident because the circumstances of their discovery are known. And that's what we mean by context in that title. And I think we took great care in that book. I'd be very surprised if there's anything in the book that isn't authentic, because we know where they came from in a systematic way.
And to mention another publication, The Cycladic Spirit is a book that first introduced me to your work, and most of the objects discussed in it are part of the collection which the public can now visit at the Goulandris Museum of Cycladic Art. I visited the museum in 2018 in Athens and was absolutely mesmerized being in the presence of these objects. Do you have a lot of involvement with this museum?
To some extent, yes. To the extent that I got to know Dolly Goulandris very well, I was introduced to her by Christos Dumas. So I got to know her very well. And indeed, she used to have the collection in her flat in Athens. She had a very large apartment, and she used to have them on display there just as decoration. They weren't behind glass or anything. They didn't need to be because she had very good security, and the public didn't visit her apartment, of course. So I got to know that material very well. She was a very kind lady, and when my wife and I went to Greece shortly after we got married, she invited us to stay in her apartment, and she then went and stayed in the country. But she left her butler to and her cook to cook for us, and we had two or three days as guests of Dolly Goulandris in her apartment amidst all these Cycladic antiquities. But then later on, she formed her museum. She made it into a formal museum, and she had, of course, permission from the Greek Archaeological Service to collect these antiquities, which were very carefully documented, and so it remains, as you say, a wonderful collection, and because she had the advice of experts, including Christos Dumas, I think, in my own opinion, it's probably safe to say that everything in it is likely to be genuine, and I think he was a splendid lady who I remember fondly.
Wow, that's incredible, and thank you so much for sharing that with us. Now, moving on to a different topic, I recently came across a word you coined called archaeogenetics, which is the study of ancient DNA. I wanted to know, what role does archaeogenetics play in being able to tell us more about the lives of prehistoric people?
I'm no great authority because I'm not a geneticist myself, but it's true and it's very important that not only do we find plant remains and animal remains, and it's possible to look at the DNA that is preserved in those prehistoric plant remains and prehistoric animal remains. We also find human remains, of course, and in favorable conditions, the DNA of those original humans, the ancient DNA, is still preserved, can be examined and studied. And so it's possible then to make comments about the possibility of invasions of people and so on. You have to document an invasion of people on archaeological grounds, but you can certainly say something. If there was a replacement of a population, that will show up in the ancient DNA, if you're fortunate enough to be able to recover it. So it's nice to say that prehistoric archaeology is one of those fields where the body of evidence is always increasing. And I think we're very lucky in that respect.
What I find so incredible about all this is that cultures that may, I assume, have been forgotten forever are reconstructed to a certain degree. And to me, that's really the magic of what archaeology provides to the world, is that it rescues traces of people who might otherwise have simply slipped into oblivion.
I think that's exactly true. And it's certainly the case that there are cultures that have been entirely forgotten and have not left very much in the way of conspicuous monuments. And then you excavate and you find traces of them. You find their pottery or their stone tools or whatever. And then we're also talking about DNA. You have a whole series of ways you can reconstruct aspects of their life and of their culture. And so that's what makes archaeology, I think, always such an exciting topic. There is always new material becoming available to the archaeologist.
It seems to me that the more we learn about our shared past, the more we understand how connected we are as a human family. And maybe I'm being a little bit overly optimistic, but I think understanding that we're all one human family could help us see beyond our superficial differences and really work together.
I think that's certainly right. We can now reconstruct the development of our species, Homo sapiens, from the previous species, and we can now, I think, be reasonably confident that the origins, our ancestors, Australopithecus, for example, originated in Africa, and we can, with increasing precision, trace the development of Australopithecus and the development gradually of our own species, Homo sapiens. And so with increasing precision, we really can begin to narrate that story with great confidence. And as you say, it does document very clearly that all humans now alive do descend from Australopithecus several million years ago.
Well, it seems we've covered a lot of ground already, and I could easily talk with you for hours, but I also want to be respectful of your time. So my last question is a more personal one. What would you say is one of your most exciting memories as an archaeologist?
Well, there are several. I think perhaps the most impressive was when I was excavating at the site of Philokopi on Milos. That's a prehistoric site. It's a Bronze Age site, but it goes right up from the early Bronze Age to the late Bronze Age. We found a ceramic stand. This was of the Mycenaean period, this late Bronze Age, around 1300 BC. And we found this ceramic stand, which was broken at the top. It was clearly a very fine object. So we sent that back to the workplace, which was not on site. It was back in the town, sort of 10 miles away. And then I was working on the site when the most wonderful ceramic head emerged. And it was clear to me that this must be the head that would fit on this ceramic stand. And when we took it back in the museum in Milos, the head fitted perfectly on. That became then an almost complete ceramic figure with head, which we once called the Lady of Philokopi. That was the finest exhibit from that excavation from Philokopi in Milos. There are lots of moments when exciting things happen, but if you want to take one that encapsulates when you put one thing together with another and suddenly you see it in all its splendor, that was a very fine moment, certainly.
That sounds like a really satisfying moment, and thanks so much for sharing that story with us. I'd like to conclude this interview with a quote of yours. At least I hope it's yours. I found it on the internet today. And the quote is, "Archaeology has the ability to open unimaginable vistas of thousands, even millions of years of past human experience."
Oh. Well, I'm happy if I said that. I probably did. I believe that to be the case. It is indeed the case. And it does indeed tell us all we can hope to know about the origins of humankind.
Well, there you have it. I think that's a wonderful conclusion to today's talk. A huge thank you, Professor Renfrew, for your time and for generously sharing your knowledge with us. It's been a real honor to speak with you.
Well, thank you. I've enjoyed our conversation. Thank you very much.
If you want to learn more about this fascinating prehistoric site, I've linked to the documentary The Enigma of Keros in the description. It goes into a lot of detail about the impressive and advanced settlement that was built at Descalio at around 2500 BC. And if you like this interview and want to see more like it, please take a moment to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel. And if you have any questions or perhaps theories of your own, you're welcome to join in the discussion by commenting below. Thanks so much for watching.